We've all been told to check our brains at the door before watching a mindless action flick. Well, I wish I had done it before seeing the cinematic atrocity that is Don't Worry, Darling. Then I wouldn't have suffered through a migraine trying to make sense of the worst sci-fi thriller I've ever seen. It's as thrilling as watching a balloon invade a country. Although I have to give props to director Olivia Wilde. She must have known from the test screenings that she had hot garbage on her hands. But she didn't just lie down and accept her fate. She orchestrated a media maelstrom of behind-the-scenes drama that resulted in so much publicity that her third of a film pulled in over $50 million in profit. Alright, I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's break down the movie. First of all, the premise is unoriginal. But we're not going to hold that against the film because everything's a copy
of a copy of a copy
these days anyway. Our characters live in a 1960s utopia, or at least the Western capitalist idea of utopia. Traditional family norms are at play here. When the husbands go off to work, the wives fill their time with house chores, shopping, and ballet classes. This guy is the first clue that something's off in this world. It's the 60s and there's an Indian guy with a white wife living the American dream. I'm kidding. We learn that not all is as it seems when the women at ballet class stand deferentially as their instructor, Shelley, walks in over ominous music. How long is this bloody scene? There's a portrait of her husband, Frank, hanging in the studio, looming over everyone. We find out early in the film that Frank runs the Victory Project. Think of it as a cultish organization promoting patriarchal values. The Victory Project has also built the town in which our characters live. All the men in town work for the organization. So, Shelley, Frank, and the Victory Project make up the heart of the mystery. But the story itself is told through the eyes of Alice, who's married to Jack. When Alice is fine, we're fine. When Alice is in danger, we fear for her. That's how good storytelling is supposed to work. But in this instance, when Alice realizes that something's wrong, we don't care. Because for most of the film, it's never made clear how Alice will be harmed if she continues to ignore the warnings and dig for the truth. We can't invest in a character if we don't know what's at stake. The problem lies in the nature of Don't Worry Darling's simulated reality. Yes, this whole thing isn't real. In other films with a similar premise, like The Matrix, The Stepford Wives, or The Truman Show, characters who become aware of their existence in a fabricated world and openly question it must suffer the consequences. Usually, that consequence is termination because they risk alerting other people to the truth and starting a revolution that would threaten the existence of the simulation. In the case of The Truman Show, they couldn't kill Truman for obvious reasons, but they gaslit him for as long as they could, causing him tremendous distress. In Don't Worry Darling's virtual reality, it's hard to manifest a compelling threat for Alice or any of the other women who were forcefully subjected to the simulation, because the men responsible did so out of love, so it stands to reason that they don't want to hurt the women any more than they have. These guys are also paying Frank to keep their wives trapped in the Victory Project, making them stakeholders in Frank's wacky vision. It makes sense that Frank and Shelley need to exercise caution when dealing with troublesome customers, especially since dying in Victory means dying in reality. The closest thing to a threat in Victory is these Squid Game mental health officers who carry no weapons and will give you a free ride if you don't want to use your legs. The lack of any tangible danger in Victory is also why Margaret's character is such a waste. Margaret could have been a hacker who has infiltrated the Victory Project. She wants to take down Frank and Shelley for what they did to her in an earlier version of the simulation. But she can only do it with the help of Alice. Our two girl heroes bond over a common cause and chase down leads together. But unfortunately, Margaret gets caught and killed by Frank because she's expendable. Now we're invested. Now we can start caring about Alice seeking revenge and freedom. But what did we get with Margaret? A weak story arc culminating in an act of last resort that had no emotional impact because her plight didn't build up meaningfully. Let's talk about the Victory Project simulation itself, because this thing is clearly in a beta state and not suited for release. For starters, the incident that led Alice to start questioning her reality was when she saw a plane crash. Now, why is there even code in the program to allow for a plane crash? There should be nothing in the skies above the town other than birds, rainbows, and maybe fireworks. And why did Frank design the lamest of all virtual worlds? Why not roleplay in a futuristic city with flying cars? Or an island with beach access? Why not fill your simulation with thrilling adventures and monsters, so the men can pretend to be heroes saving their damsels in distress? Out of all the places one can choose to be stranded in, I imagine a 60s suburb in the desert is somewhere at the bottom of that list. As it stands, a Victory Project subscription should cost less than Netflix basic sub. Next, what's up with the rule preventing the men from talking about their jobs at Victory Project? It only fuels more suspicion amongst the womenfolk. The wives are already being lied to about everything else. Why not just tell them that the men are working on something important, like a time-traveling machine, or a way to reunite One Direction? According to the Victory Project terms and conditions, the men are only allowed to spend a certain number of hours in the simulation a day. Fine, the men have to make money in the real world and change the soiled diapers of their women. I get it. But what I don't get is why the simulation isn't powered down when the men are not in it. It's not like the women are taking on quests and leveling up while in VR. They only exist for their husbands, so why not just put the simulation on standby and save server rental costs and pass the savings on to the men? Clearly, I've thought about this too much. Alright, there are a lot of issues with the film and I can't go through them all. But I think many of Don't Worry Darling's flaws stem from it trying to be both a sci-fi thriller and a film about women's empowerment. In the right hands, it's doable. But what we have here are characters who constantly do or say things that muddy up the rules of the simulation, which makes the sci-fi aspect less enjoyable. Here's an example. In this dinner scene, Alice has a big moment where she reveals to everyone at the table how so many couples in Victory have similar stories about how they met and where they had their honeymoon. So something must be wrong. She's trying to get them to see that there's a malicious force pulling their strings. But why would this be new information to the women? They talk to one another all the time, so they must know each other's backstories. They're just unable to connect the dots because the simulation affects their cognition, on top of denying them access to their real memories. We know this because both Alice and Margaret were only able to start piecing together the inconsistencies after touching the glass portal thingy. But this scene is played like Alice is owning everyone in the room with her Sherlock-like deduction skills. Everyone's faces should be bored or unimpressed because she's spouting statements that everyone knows. But that would make the scene fall flat. So instead, we see the men squirming in their seats and the women having flickers of doubt on their faces. This establishes Alice as a foil against the baddies, but it makes the laws of the simulation more opaque to us. Isn't it also weird that the Victory Project is capable of suppressing real memories and planting false ones when you first enter the simulation? But when you exit the simulation and then go back in, like what happened with Alice and Margaret, it can't repeat the process. Finally, I wish Frank and Shelley's stories were more fleshed out. We never find out what their motivations are for creating the Victory Project. Frank's speeches are so vague, you don't know what his end goals are, or what exactly he expects from his followers.
It's just too easy to get distracted by what seems. Much more difficult, braver, I would say, to search for what could be.
What? And how did he get so many followers? How did he manage to create a virtual dystopia made up of at least 3 lines of code? What's Shelley's role in all this? So many questions, perhaps better left unanswered. That's it from me. Thank you for watching. No. No.